The Plein Air Easton Podcast is brought to you by the Avalon Foundation, enriching the lives of those on the eastern shore of Maryland through the arts. Visit avalonfoundation.org for details on events, performances, and educational programming offered throughout the year. Today's episode is sponsored by JFM Enterprises, providing distinctive ready-made and custom frames and moldings to the trade since 1974. Visit jfm.net to view their catalog of designs.
You know, you kind of go back to go forward. You know, at the end of the day, I'm really, you know, a traditional painter. I love painting representationally. I love painting the world around me. That's part of why I love plein air. I love just going, you know, immersing myself in a neighborhood, in a community, in a landscape, and having that sort of conversation and that experience with basically mud and sticks with hair on the end of them.
Welcome, everyone, to Plein Air Easton Podcast. Today, sitting in for Jess Bellis, as her sidekick is Marie Nuttall. Marie, thank you for joining us today.
Thanks. Thank you, Tim.
Going to talk to Garin Baker. We had a nice talk with him. What did you like about that conversation?
I love what he's up to.
You love the murals and things
like that. I really do love the murals a lot. And I just liked hearing his progression from realizing how he was an artist into, you know, the grand things that he's doing now.
And it's very different from what people have said before in terms of, you know, just like the type of work that he did along the way. But it was very obvious he knew he was an artist from the very beginning.
Right. He has been basically making a living at making art his whole entire life.
Exactly, nothing else.
Right.
And really, really cool information, I thought. This is just stuff you don't think it's out there, but art is everywhere. And if you love it, you can certainly make a career out of it.
Truly.
He's definitely got a lot to say, and it's all very interesting. Let's talk to Garin Baker.
Yes, here we go.
Garin, thanks for coming on the Plein Air Podcast.
Oh, thanks for inviting me. I'm thrilled.
Hi, Garin. It's good to see you.
Always good to see you guys.
Marie, do you have anything you wanted to start with? Garin, what are you up to these days? I mean, I know you do a lot of big projects, and it's an art podcast, and I think it's be kind of interesting for people to maybe talk about, you know, how you went from plein air to the big, amazing stuff that you're doing.
Well, it's always a juggling act because I've been doing public art, large-scale public art murals for about almost 18 years now. So the plein air was always intermingled, as well as commissions and teaching. So artists are, you know, like the four-legged stool, you know what I mean?
Right.
That's the thing that keeps it all going, is that you can kind of play in a lot of different playgrounds. And so plein air wasn't like it came before or it came after. It was kind of simultaneous.
That's great.
So Garin, when I think of your work, I think of the figure taking the forefront of a lot of your work. Is that true? Is that how you see yourself as well?
Yeah, I mean, primarily from my training is figurative, because I went to a great school and high school, and was really fortunate to come across some amazing figurative painters. Now, growing up in New York City, I was able to go to the High School of Art and Design, and miraculously at that time, there were a couple of really incredible high school teachers of mine. One of them was Max Ginsburg, and the other one was Erwin Greenberg. And these are probably the preeminent at that. You know, now they're very well known.
Mm-hmm.
Max just is going to be awarded, I think, a Lifetime Achievement Award at the Portrait Convention coming up.
Nice.
These were figurative, you know, traditional, representational. I hate to call them, you know, realist. Max is sort of a social realist. But, you know, during the late sort of mid-70s, when I was coming, you know, of age in high school, they couldn't get arrested. You know, they couldn't show, or not that they couldn't show, but there wasn't really an audience that was sympathetic to their work, being figurative painters in New York at that time. It was very conceptual, very abstract, and so traditional painters, not that they ever went anywhere, they were always around. These two guys found themselves as high school art teachers.
Right, right, yeah.
So basically, I stumbled upon it, and they had started a program called the Early Morning Group. Some people call it the Old Hat Club. So I stumbled upon them and was, a young 15, 16-year-old kid, from any, typical neighborhood in Upper Manhattan. Kids came from all across New York City to come to the High School of Art and Design. It was very much like that movie Fame. You've seen that movie?
Yes.
I love that movie.
Me too.
That was geared towards kids in the performing arts. And New York City at that time had several high schools that were sort of focused on science, on art, on music and dance, and High School of Art and Design, music and art, performing arts were sort of at the forefront of that. So Max and Greeny, as we called them, had an early morning group, they convinced the CSEA, which were the people that really ran the school system, the maintenance people, they opened the school up, 6 o'clock in the morning, and they convinced them to allow Max and Greeny to basically convince wayward students to come and sit and pose, and invited a bunch of us high school kids to come 2 or 3 hours before first period bell and paint from life. And so it was really an amazing kind of opportunity, and it grew into something that to this day people really celebrate. A lot of incredible young painters, New York painters, came out of there. Steve Issel, Willie Lowe, Ricky Mujica, myself, a pretty famous guy by the name of Mark Texera, who made, his sort of name, doing storyboards for a lot of the Marvel comics, and now he's done a lot of storyboards for a lot of the Hollywood movies that are celebrating Marvel comics now. So it was a great time, those early years. So in terms of me being like a figurative painter, that's where kind of it all comes from. Trained as a figurative, painting from life, basically, getting somebody to sit still for a couple hours and painting them,
And you, in company like that now, you can say, do you guys all get together and have reunions where you're like, I knew you when you were 15 and awkward?
it's really bizarre because, and it fills, my heart and soul every day, because Irwin, he sort of recognized a little bit of my, early talent, I guess you would call it. And he sort of pointed me, he's like, looks at me and says, oh, you're an Upper West Side kid. And I was like, yeah. He says, okay, so you take the crosstown bus. And then, he's like, you ride right by the Art Students League on 57th Street. He's like, you should get off a couple of stops early and go in there, And this is when I was 17, 16, 17. And I stumbled in there, picked up a catalog, and started studying there as well, taking some classes in the late afternoon, in the evening. I got a really amazing tutelage, at a very early age. And now, full circle, almost 40 years, let's say 30, yeah, almost 40 years later, I'm an instructor at the Art Students League presently.
When you said that the teacher noticed you were good at something, he noticed your drawings. What were you good at when you first started doing it, when you were in high school? What part of the drawing were you good at? I don't even know if that question makes any sense, but you obviously weren't an expert yet, but they saw something, what's, do you see that in students that you work with now?
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's, you know, behind the rawness and behind the, you know, the lack of language and sort of the lack of sort of facility in terms of communicating, what you see is an ability to be authentic, in a sense. What you see is an ability to communicate a point of view.
That's great.
So can we talk about the segue into your mural art? Like, when did that happen? And I understand now you're running the public art mural company. So can you tell us about that project?
You're looking at the company. So when I got out of college, back in probably the early 80s, very early 80s, I had a lot of figurative traditional paintings, you know, paintings from the model, paintings, plein air paintings that Irwin was one of the first people to take a bunch of us young painters out into the street and to paint New York City, just bring our, you know, plein air. He called it, you know, painting outdoors. It wasn't really called plein air back then, but
it didn't have a fancy French word slapped on it.
Well, you know, in France, I guess they called it that, but in New York or wherever, we just called it, you know, painting outdoors. At that time, I, you know, would show my work to galleries getting out of college and, you know, wide-eyed and bushy-tailed, and they would look at my work and they would go, oh, so you're like a photorealist. And I would be like, okay. And so a lot of us figurative traditional painters found our way, you know, to make a living. We were young in our early 20s. Some of us had young families. Some of us, you know, we had to figure out how to make a living, you know, living in New York City. And there was a lot of opportunity in the illustration business for people that had skills that could still paint and draw from life, you know.
And that's making a living doing art, right, Garin?
No, absolutely. We were making a living doing art, but we were painting various commercial type imagery, you know, like book covers, advertising. And we were doing, I was doing a lot of book covers, done well over 300-400 book covers as well as I can remember. And they were, some were romance, some were young adult, some were Westerns. And these were sort of your pulp, you know, kind of commercial, you know, the stuff, the paperback novels.
Did you ever paint Fabio?
Oh yeah. I've worked with Fabio quite a bit, actually.
Nuh-uh.
As I remember him, he was actually a lot of fun to work with because he took the whole thing with like a real positive kind of wonderful attitude. This was before the advent of sort of the digital kind of revolution. And then when the digital revolution came about, everything changed in terms of how art directors and how publishing companies were envisioning and deciding about how to create art. They didn't really need sort of traditional painters anymore because they could take photo reference and digitize it and stylize it and create book covers just with photo reference. So we were kind of becoming obsolete in a sense.
Okay.
And so many of us at that time saw the writing on the wall and we were kind of like, okay, so let's, and me in particular, I had a young family at the time, and I had moved up here, and I'd started renovating this big old place. And there were a lot of my kids were young; they were in elementary school, and you know, we were parents, we were PTA parents, you know. And
right.
I would go into the schools, and I would go, "Gosh, you know what you guys need in this school? You need some murals, you know."
Oh, I love that.
Work with the school district and principals and, you know, get, you know, artists in residency, little teeny tiny budgets that would pay for some paint and some brushes. And we would work with these kids and some of the art teachers and do really cool murals. And so that was kind of a segue. Not that, you know, there was a lot of money in it, but it was this kind of a segue creatively. and potentially there was a way to do public art. I didn't really see it in particular at the time or specifically, but as I look back, that was the way I became a public artist or a muralist.
Did you ever do any graffiti?
I grew up in Harlem in the Upper West Side, and I grew up with a lot of really famous graffiti artists. This was the advent, in the 70s and 80s, the advent.
Wait, can I just ask you, do you know Banksy?
Yeah, well, no, I don't know Banksy.
Does anybody?
Greeny taught him a couple years after you were there.
I know San Juan, who is Ricky Mujica's brother. Ricky Mujica and I actually grew up in the same neighborhood. And this was the time, this was the advent of the hip-hop, revolution was in its early stages.
It sounds like you've been sort of like anything to keep making art, Garin, and not necessarily going into different festivals, but using your talent that you discovered at a very young age, or are lucky enough to discover when you were a teenager, just constantly use that to keep your career going.
Yeah, I mean, eventually, afterwards, I sort of opened my sort of perspective in terms of, investigating and looking out there in the larger world, the larger landscape, and finding there were public art networks that I could join. There were arts commissions and art organizations all across the country that had instituted Percent for Art programs. And they were in existence and they were thriving and they were ongoing. And I figured, I was like, wow, if I sort of plug into these networks, I can hear about municipal projects and also private, corporate projects that are sort of in the landscape that a lot of people don't know about, and was fortunate enough to get a few projects along the way. And that's kind of how I transitioned, in a sense, away from, commercial illustration to being a muralist.
Right.
You learn as you go. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
Life school is in session every day.
That's right. That's right. I love that. Garin, is this where we can talk about 28 Blocks?
Yeah, 28 Blocks. one of my cooler projects.
Yes, can I tell you, I fan 28 Blocks murals so much. I have field tripped over there. I have seen it in person. I love the story behind it. Can you tell us about that?
28 Blocks was it was like peeling an onion, Initially, it was a public call coming out of Washington, D.C., but this is the city of D.C., not federal. This was, the city, but the District of Columbia. And so they have, a government entity, that runs the city. It's got a pretty healthy budget, but they also have open calls for public art projects. And it was a public call that went out, and I read it. And I looked at the size of that monstrous building. I was like, okay, that's going to be very interesting. And I basically submitted, like I do for a lot of these projects, because 80% of them, you know, they go to somebody else. Mm-hmm. They go to some other talented, amazing artist, You're just not right for that project. That's really the life of an artist, is to, submit and submit and submit, and sometimes, the stars aligned and you're right for the project and they recognize it and you're interested in it and you get the gig. And what was unique about this site was that it's about a mile north east of the Capitol Dome, just about one station behind where Union Station is. I don't know if you know D.C. at all, but you probably do. And so this was right on the line where Amtrak sort of enters the city of D.C., where the metro, the D.C. metro enters.
Yeah, the metro goes right by it, doesn't it?
It goes right by it. So I looked at this side of this building, and I was like, okay, that's really cool. This thing has a huge amount of visibility. 40 to 50,000 people a day ride by this thing going
exactly.
when I looked at that site, I was like, this is such a great opportunity, especially for all of these commuters to sort of get a welcoming sign, you know, welcome to DC. You're in DC now, you know. I thought, what better than, you know, an image of the Lincoln Memorial, which is one of the most iconic American Washington, D.C., you know, images that, you know, it's so, it's obvious, you know. And right. So that's when the onion started to get peeled. So when I got back to the studio and I started to do some research, the Lincoln Memorial statue carved by, you know, designed by Daniel Chester French around 1915 or 16. And he carved this 11-foot high statue of Lincoln, you know, monumentally, sort of sublimely sitting in the great throne, the great chair there, you know.
Yes.
The design of it is quite marvelous. Obviously, anybody that's been to the Lincoln Memorial and walked up those steps is struck with a great sense of, you know, of patriotism and humanity and just spirit of what it really is to be an American. I mean, there really is a compelling nature to that memorial. And so in order to carve this, they needed, you know, some of the finest white marble available in the world. And it just so happens that a small town in Northwest Georgia, there's a quary where they blast and carve, you know, and basically chisel blocks of marble out of the side of a mountain. But at that time, 1917, 1918, most of the people that worked at that quarry were the first and second generation of freed African Americans. And so black men, primarily, that worked at that quarry in Northwest Georgia, carved 28 blocks of white marble out of the side of this mountain. And I just thought that that was so profound, in a sense. And so that's where the title came out, you know, is 28 blocks, because I really wanted to tell a story about how they built the statue. You know, slaves and immigrants built this country, you know, and so I really, that was the story that I really wanted to tell.
Well, I mean, I can definitely say too, I mean, like I said, I love so much about the story and the backstory. I think that it's so meaningful, but if you ever get a chance to go to DC and see this mural, Tim, to stand in the shadows of it, it's truly awesome.
It's about 70 feet high by 160 feet long.
So you had 120 sections, and you say you rolled
roughly 120 sections. Each section was 5 feet across by 10 feet high.
That seems to be a lot of planning. I mean, you know, because I was going to ask, how do you go from painting, say, you know, 6 foot painting, you know, to a 70-foot painting, but it sounds like you do it in increments, obviously. But it seems like a lot of planning.
You do it with bigger brushes, you
know. Right, yeah, bigger brushes.
When you do the rendering that you do your sort of presentation with, before you even get the contract to do the, you know, the actual job. The rendering was, let's see, I think if I'm probably 50 inches high by, I think, 120 inches long. So it was a pretty good size rendering.
Right.
In charcoal on paper, you know, that I basically showed to this, what they call an artist selection committee. And so when they say, hey, you got the job, and you go, oh my God, how am I actually going to do this thing?
Right. That's the part. Yeah. That's what I'm asking. Yeah. That part.
Careful. Sometimes it's kind of like, be careful what you wish for, you know, you might get it, you know?
It's such a, interesting and, long journey from, high school in the upper west side of, or upper side of Manhattan, to painting these 70-foot murals. You know, I don't think we've ever really talked to an artist, or I haven't talked to an artist yet, who, you know, sort of just kept doing things in the art world that may have been different the whole way through to get where they're going. It seems like a lot of them are, well, I keep painting, or I join competitions, or I do a lot of these things. So it's really been inspirational, I think, for a lot of people to hear of, especially when you talk about, getting involved in these art leagues and these things that are out there that people don't really know about, that are there for the artists. So,
yeah, and how much art like infiltrates the community and our lives.
If you think about the way he described his career today, I mean, it's all around you.
Exactly.
What I mean? It's in the book covers. It's here, but now you don't draw them anymore. It's all digital, but you came through that whole process. Very, very informative.
Well, Tim, at the end of the day, I kind of go back to go forward. At the end of the day, I'm really, a traditional painter. I love painting representationally. I love painting the world around me. That's part of why I love plein air. I love just going, immersing myself in a neighborhood, in a community, in a landscape, and having that sort of conversation and that experience with basically mud and sticks with hair on the end of them. It's really that simple. There's something about the purity of that. Whether it was murals or illustrations or corporate commissions or even private sales to collectors, those are afterthoughts. Those are the sort of the genesis of what the initial impetus is, the initial passion, and the initial honest kind of moment that you're trying to create and express something. That's what I think. That's why painting, as opposed to many of the other art forms, I think continues to linger in these complex, technologically advanced times.
Uh-huh.
There's something that's very true. There's something that's very authentic about the individual and about that individual's need to say something about their time here, whether it be a long life or a short life. There's something very special about that, and there's something very human about that. And I think when an artist is able to sort of honestly convey that, the audience responds to it, and the audience sees themselves in the work and is able to celebrate what it is to be alive in this moment in time. And I think that's what it was to me as a high school student, and that's what it is to me even more so to this day. I'm getting a little older, and I think the mural business for me, I see so many wonderful young muralists, and working on a 60, 70 foot building is not like what I relish that much. I really like to just take my paints and go paint more and more as I get older. In my studio, creating compositions and stories. I love telling stories. And the years that I was at Easton, that was really what was so miraculous and marvelous about it. When I got there, I was kind of like, why am I here? I'm really not a landscape painter. You know what I mean? I mean, I love painting outdoors, and I love trying to understand what light is and what light means to creating, a visual poetry on a two-dimensional surface, because that's really, to me, what plein air is. That's what it teaches you. It's a way to communicate what the light of the day is at that moment in time. And as a training purposes, I tell all of my students, if you really want to understand light, get out of the studio and go outdoors, because that's where you're going to learn about light. And if you're painting anything, that's what you're painting. And so when I got to Easton in 2013, these are the best landscape painters in working today. And I'm like, what the hell am I doing here? And what I found was the complete generosity of artist to artist. And it's in one way or another, standing beside some, the best of the best and painting alongside them. It's a really being a figurative painter, making a living as an artist. All of that went right out the window because I was really humbled by watching some of those artists paint. And my hands would drop to my side and I would just watch them paint. And one day, Ken DeWard, he looks over at me and he's like, well, why aren't you painting? And I was just like, dude, I'm just watching you paint because you're awesome. And
he will love to hear that.
And I are great friends now. Paint together all the time. In fact, next month we'll be up in northern Vermont painting winter scenes, just for the hell of it, And so Ken looked at me and he was like, dude, I got a great spot. You would love this spot. And I was like, he's like, oh, I know your work. And, you know, and so he took me to the spot and I painted there. And that's where I ran across that, you know, the water guy, you know, the waterman, the crab fisherman.
Yeah.
Like 20 a bushel.
Just by happenstance, you know, I ran into this young kid who was coming off one of the boats and he looked at my painting. And he was like, oh, yeah, I heard about you artists that are here in town painting this week. Yeah, that's nice. You know, have a nice day, you know. And I said, hold on, you know, because he was like right out of Central Casting. I mean, he was like so typically what he was authentically and honestly, you know, without any, you know, apology. You know, he was who he was. And I was just like, dude, will you pose for me? You know, because I'm, you know, and he was like, what? You know, he kind of like stepped back and I was like, no, I'm actually a professional at this, you know. And so I did that painting one afternoon, you know, with him sitting on the boat and his captain sitting across from him. And I just had a great time. They were great. They talked about their lives. They talked about their families. They were interested in what I was doing. I was interested in what they were doing. And I put the painting aside, you know, and that was what it was. And lo and behold, it resonated with the audience and it resonated with the judge. And I was fortunate enough to win grand prize that year.
So, Garin, can I just tell you this side story? So 2013 was the year before I got the job as coordinator of Plein Air Easton, and I was a cashier in the hallway when that waterman saw your painting for the first time. He went into the winner's gallery. He was off the chart. He was so stinking excited. He was telling his friends, it's me, I won.
That's great. I love that.
He was thrilled too.
Yeah.
I love your talk about honesty and you know, just you know, integrity and that sort of thing in your subjects and what you try to go for, and you know, and something that you are lucky to have found it, that was your calling, because it just seems like it totally absorbs you. You know?
And I think being able to share it in the way that you do is so, so important. And I really appreciate that about you too, that you're sharing your passion and your art.
And in really ways for people who have the same sort of passion to feel confident that they can make it through it. You know, I mean, being in New York City obviously helps for what you want to do as a painter. And maybe you don't have that many opportunities if someone's listening in, you know, somewhere in the middle of the country where, you know, they feel like they're in a much smaller area. But just the many facets of your career, a lot of people say they came from, you know, drawing, you know, design or engineering, and then they just plein air paint. I mean, you really have run a large gap. I mean, we have to see if anybody else has done any graffiti. You know.
Yeah, Tim, I mean, you know, we're on a quest. You know, I see young artists that are, you know, in my class, in my studio, you know, assisting me and mentoring with me, you know, working on murals and painting the figure, you know, in an academic setting. I mean, they're on a quest. Seek it and you will find it. It really comes down to your ability to, you know, number one, decipher information and then put it to work. And so, yeah, that passion, you know, till the day I die, you know, I mean, and many of these young artists, you know, are the same way. I mean, it hasn't diminished one iota. You know, there still is that, as I said before, that need to sort of plant your flag and make something that that communicates something about your time here. You know, Kilroy was here. You know what I mean?
There's right, sure, exactly. Exactly.
I don't know what it is. I can't expound about it. You know, as a scholarly person, I just know it. And I appreciate the opportunity to maybe sometimes my students say, geez, Garin, you're so intense. And I'm like, yeah, I'm sorry. I am intense about this
stuff. Nothing wrong with that. No, yeah, great. Great. Thanks a lot, Garin. We really appreciate it.
All right, Tim. Thank you, Marie.
Thank you. Garin is going to be joining us for Plein Air Easton this summer, July 12th through 19th. He's going to be one of our featured alumni in Coffee and Conversation, and we're cooking up some other things. He might do a demo for us too as well, so we're really looking forward to seeing him this July.
The Plein Air Easton podcast is brought to you by the Avalon Foundation and was produced by Nick Richards. Our theme music was generously provided by Blue Dot Sessions, with additional episode music by Scott Grattan. Remember to rate, comment, and subscribe. You can learn more about Plein Air Easton at pleinaireeston.com.